I did something that I do very rarely. I thought about this and I started preparing a month ago. And I read through it, and I opened up and said, oh, cool, I didn't know, I don't have the Bible memorized yet, nor will I till I'm in heaven. But I didn't realize that Joshua 6 was the Battle of Jericho, which is probably one of the first stories that I remember remembering from when I was a kid. That's why I got excited. But initially, a month ago, I was looking at it and I was a little concerned that first it's such a familiar story and there aren't that many points to be made from it that I wasn't sure I was going to get 2 hours of material. 4 crazy weeks later, after things flew by, I picked it up again and got back to my norm, which was preparing a day or two ahead of time. And because I had the much more time and thought put into it and prayerfully considered it, I prayed about it before developing this teaching. Now, that's a pious way of saying the reality is that I frantically prepared on the day before hoping for inspiration, which is what happened. In this time that I spent yesterday, God made one thing perfectly clear. I didn't need the old sermon formula of 3 points and an illustration. There is one point, and that's the name this week and next week. And it's one word, Joshua 6, to me, and what we're learning is about obedience. We're going to start with reading, and we will be reading scripture more than I'm going to be talking tonight. You just heard most of it. But starting with verse 1. Now Jericho was securely shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out, and none came in. And the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho into your hand, its king and the mighty men of valor. Okay, the Hebrew meaning here implies, and the English does as well, that this is already a done deal, that he has delivered them to Joshua and to Israel at this point. And while the Hebrews were pretty tough and a pretty big bunch, they were a force to be reckoned with, the inhabitants of Jericho were fierce, experienced, better armed, and they're called in the Bible men of valor. We usually hear that referring to most often David's men, but here we hear it referring to these Canaanites. So fighting against them in a fortified city would be a daunting, if not impossible, undertaking without a long siege. And the implication of the text is that God has already given them a certain and easy victory. So continuing, verse 3. You shall march around the city, all you men of war. You shall go all around the city once. This you shall do 6 days. And 7 priests shall bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns. Visual aid. Thank you, Steve. Before the ark. But the 7th day you shall march around the city 7 times, and the priests shall blow the trumpets. It shall come to pass when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, and when you hear the sound of the trumpet, that all the people shall shout with a great shout. Then the wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people shall go up every man straight before him. Okay, here God is giving Joshua a very clear, precise set of instructions as to how this easy victory will be accomplished. Continuing verse 6. Then Joshua, the son of Nun, called the priests and said to them, take up the Ark of the Covenant and let 7 priests bear 7 trumpets of ram's horns before the Ark of the Lord. And he said to the people, proceed and march around the city. And let him who is armed advance before the ark of the Lord. Okay, Joshua was already in place, prepared for a siege when he received these instructions. It's clearly stated in verse 1 that it was already underway when it says that now Jericho was securely shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out, none came in. That sounds an awful lot like a besieged city. As a great general and a leader, Joshua had almost certainly made battle plans for how to take this well-defended, fortified city. The Hebrew implies immediate action. He did not hesitate to change whatever plans he had. God's plans became his own plans. And at once he called the priests and relayed God's plan and their part in it. As we read on, we see the obedience of the priests implied here as well. So in verse 8, so it was, and chapter 6. So it was when Joshua had spoken to the people that the seven priests bearing the seven trumpets of ram's horns before the Lord advanced and blew the trumpets. This is a baby. The big ones are louder and a little lower, but there's your trumpet. So they blew the trumpet, and that helped me lose my place there. And the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord followed them. The armed men went before the priests who blew the trumpets, and the rear guard came after the Ark, while the priests continued blowing the trumpets. Now Joshua had commanded the people, saying, "You shall not shout or make any noise with your voice, nor shall a word proceed out of your mouth, until the day I say to you, shout, then you shall shout." So he had the Ark of the Lord circle the city, going around it once. Then they came into the camp and lodged in the camp. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priest took up the Ark of the Lord. Then seven priests, bearing seven trumpets of ram's horns before the Ark of the Lord, went on continually and blew with the trumpets. And the armed men went before them. But the rear guard, it really sounds like I'm reading the same thing, doesn't it? But that's a new verse. But the rear guard came after the Ark of the Lord while the priests continued blowing the trumpets. And the second day, they marched around the city once and returned to the camp. So they did 6 days. The people, just as the priests, were obedient in following the very specific instructions that were given by Joshua from the Lord. Are you noticing a pattern here of obedience? God speaks, and Joshua is obedient. Joshua speaks, the priests and the people are obedient. God gave Joshua very specific instructions, but this story is actually rather unusual in that God also explains what the results are going to be. He tells Joshua up front the way through to the end, and he really doesn't leave out much. He includes what has to be done with the inhabitants and what to do with the spoils of war. The whole plan is laid out to Joshua. I can't think of another time other than like building the ark, but in battle, I can't think of another time where all the plan was laid out beforehand. Raising up the arms, yeah, maybe, but that didn't really, it basically says you're gonna lose when they're down and win when it's up, but it doesn't say much about it. But he does give very specific instructions, which does happen often, but also details on what will happen and, you know, how the spoils are to be split up, which in this case, what little was kept all went to God. Did Joshua explain everything to the priests and to the people? We don't know. As much as I hate it, because I like to know everything before I embark on stuff, if he did, there's no indication that he did that. The people trusted Joshua in hearing from the Lord. And even Joshua, who was given the complete vision, likely wondered why it had to be done in such a weird, ritualistic fashion. The priests and the people almost certainly had no clue what was being accomplished by taking a solemn daily hike around the city without any sound other than the shofars being sounded by the priests. There were no weapons drawn. They're in battle, but there's no indication they had their weapons out or were doing anything other than just taking a hike. There's none of the normal, very involved procedures of laying siege to a city. And I suspect the Canaanites that are there are likely having a good time making fun of these strange folks. Now, I suspect that they were wondering what was going on. Some might have been fearful, but I would be willing to bet that for the most part, many were just saying, what are these characters doing? This is not a way to make war. So it's a nice long hike that starts early in the morning. Now, I looked into this, and there's a lot of people that have tried to figure out how far they walked. And you also mentioned how many people there were. The speculation online is fairly, there isn't as much as I expected, and what I did get wasn't satisfying. So I did a little math myself. The size of Jericho, we know because the ruins have been found. And it was about 9 acres total, and the walled inner part was about 6 acres. So looking at, they probably don't want to walk right close within, they did have ranged weapons even in this distant historic time. So I'm guessing that they were at least 100 yards from the wall for their hike. And you know, that there were a lot of folks doing it. Even if it was just the men of arms, that was hundreds of thousands. So this is, the walk is not, it's going to totally encircle the city, because that comes out to, in my calculations, just a touch shy of a mile. I mean, it's maybe 20 or 30 feet less than a mile. So it's not a bad day's hike to get out and walk before breakfast and go home and back to camp. Of course, to get all the people to do it, I'm sure it took a good bit longer than the 20 to 30 minutes that even a slow march would take to get to go a mile. All righty. This was actually the first battle for Joshua after going into the Promised Land. And he had lived a life, he had done spy work. We know from the rest of it that he was quite a general. But this was also his greatest victory, in my opinion. And the only thing that Joshua did to earn this victory was to obey the Lord's commands. And he did that down to the smallest details. And I know all of you are quite familiar with the teaching of PD and others about the importance of the number 7. But we see it quite a bit in this. We are doing it 7 times. There are 7 trumpets, 7 priests. On the 7th day, there are 7 trips around the city. And a 7-mile hike before you're going into a fight is fairly common, but that's a pretty good march before you go into battle. All righty, seven is the number of completeness, and it's one of the most significant numbers in Judaism, and there are many, many things. Just look up 7 in Judaism, and you'll run across a lot of good stuff. So let's read what happens on day 7, starting in verse 15. But it came to pass on the 7th day that they rose early about the dawning of day and marched around the city 7 times in the same manner. On that day only they marched around the city 7 times. And the 7th time it happened when the priests blew the trumpets that Joshua said to the people, "Shout, for the Lord has given you the city. Now the city shall be doomed by the Lord to destruction, it and all who are in it. Only Rahab the harlot shall live, she and all who are with her in the house, because she hid the messengers that we sent. And you, by all means, abstain from the accursed things, lest you become accursed when you take of the accursed things, and make the camp of Israel a curse, and trouble it. But all the silver and gold and vessels of bronze and iron consecrated to the Lord, they shall come into the treasury of the Lord. So here on the last day, and somebody said I should holler like I'm talking to hundreds of thousands when I do that, because how that word got passed is probably a miracle in itself. But everyone, as far as we could see, and we would know because God would have done something if these instructions had not been followed. So we receive the rest of the instructions from Joshua to the people. And this is at the end of at least a 7-mile march. God pronounces through Joshua that there will be no looting or spoil. If this is violated, it would have brought a curse on the entire nation. So we think it was obeyed. So then what happens? Verse 20. So the people shouted when the priest blew the trumpets. And it happened when the people heard the sound of the trumpet, and the people shouted with a great shout, that the wall fell down flat. Then the people went up into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, ox and sheep and donkey, with the edge of the sword. One more interesting point here. It was actually a double-walled city, and it was massive. But the way the walls fell down, it made a natural ramp to get on to the inner walls. And in the excavation, now the first excavations of the site didn't discover this, and there's a lot of stuff you can find about Jericho that sounds like it may not be, that the biblical record is not correct. But with further digs and more looking into it, not only have they determined that the timing was right, which was one of the big issues, that the first person that did the study of it in dating it thought that it was destroyed hundreds of years before, and that there wasn't a Jericho left when Joshua got there. But that has been updated, and the timing is right. And one of the most interesting things is, with her house being part of the wall, now we hear the wall was destroyed, but this was the inner wall, and that section was found reasonably intact. So her house and all the people in it were still standing based on the study of the ruins. So the more we learn, the more we realize how accurate the Bible is in these things. So back to the story. The children of Israel, Joshua, were obedient, and things went exactly as God told them. There's no indication of any combat losses. That's miraculous. It does not say anything about, and it often is the case in battle, you'll hear about the losses there, but there's no indication that that happened. The walls fell, the city fell immediately, and they were surrounding the city with the number of people they had, even though they're moving around it. So everybody went straight up in, and it was an overwhelming force against a fairly small force in the city. I mean, there may have been as many as 10,000 inside, but that was considerably less than the Israelis had, or Israelites had. Okay. Jericho was taken. All the Canaanites in the city were killed except Rahab and her household. And we're going to get to them next week when we continue. The fall of Jericho was around 1400 BC and was written about as a testimony to faith and obedience 15 centuries later in Hebrews 11, 30 through 31. I mean, they're still talking about it a millennia and a half later. That verse reads, "By faith the walls of Jericho fell down after they were encircled for 7 days. By faith, the harlot Rahab did not perish with those who did not believe when she had received the spies with peace." So one of the things we want to look at in obedience, it requires faith. It also displays love. When we are obedient, we are showing love, whether that's to a spouse, a parent, or God. And for the rest of tonight, I'm going to give a few of the many verses in the Bible about obedience for us to ponder and then talk about. I'll start with 1 Samuel 15:22. And if you grew up Baptist, you can probably hang with me, but don't try if you're not a sword drill master. So Samuel said, Has the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to heed than the fat of rams. Deuteronomy 28:1. Now it shall come to pass, if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God, to observe carefully all his commandments, which I command you today, that the Lord your God will set you high above all nations of the earth. And then jumping to Romans 5, verse 19. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so also by one man's obedience many will be made righteous. And that's referring to Adam and Jesus. 2 Corinthians 10:4 through 6. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. In writing this verse, I kind of wondered if this is an allusion by Paul to Jericho, because that's kind of what happened there. The walls were torn down. And what does Jesus say about obedience? That's always, for me, the most important place to go. And John repeats it many times in his gospel, so I pretty much stuck with the gospel of John for these verses. And that's why John is both my favorite book of the Bible, and along with James, it's one of the most challenging books of the Bible for me. Let's look at John's gospel, 8:51. Most assuredly, I say to you, if anyone keeps my word, he shall never see death. 14:15. If you love me, keep my commandments. 14:21. He who has my commandments and keeps them, it is he who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. 23:24. Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. He who does not love me does not keep my words, and the word which you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. 15:10. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. 15:20. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also. And that is another reference, as we had in Joshua, to obey those that are following God. All righty, and let's see. Well, I think that's all I'd put down here. I could have done a much longer list of God requiring obedience, but we don't have time for that. And I know that's something that we all struggle with. So I don't want to beat you up for an hour. 30 minutes is enough. And I didn't actually give them out, except for those that were here early. But these are life lessons and questions that we're going to break into smaller groups here shortly. But I want to point out a few things that I want you to understand. One of them is one of the questions. I'll sort of give you the answer. But God loves you the same, regardless. You are not earning his love by being obedient. You're showing your love. We need to understand, well, first of all, we're all part of the fall. It is not our nature to be obedient. It's our nature to do it our way. And we're going to talk some about that when we get into the smaller groups. And I'm hoping that you guys will be open. I want to set it up for small groups of three. And you know what? I think we got, well, Nick and I are odd men out, but look at the rest of the group. They're groups of three, and we can put an elder at each one. Not that that means a lot, but I like the symmetry of that. But, and Nick and I can just drop in on another, on a group, unless we make you nervous, and then send us away. But we'll do that shortly. But in this lesson, they hear from God, they obey God, God does exactly what he outlines that he's going to do. And that is a truth that we can count on. Now, the obeying immediately, not an easy thing to do. Knowing when you're hearing from God, I struggle with trusting people that hear from God constantly and know exactly what he said. I think they're getting more internal voices than they are God voices. At least that's my experience. If yours is different, I don't want to challenge that, but I have sometimes absolutely known, like I did with this. I mean, I knew that was God saying, you only have one thing to teach, and that's obedience. Because that's not my nature. So when it's something I wouldn't think of, that's sometimes a hint it's God. But we're not always going to know when we are hearing from God in prayer and meditation. Sometimes you'll know absolutely. Sometimes you'll wonder if that's you. Sometimes you'll wonder if it's the enemy, because it doesn't sound right. There's one way to check that. Anybody want to guess what that might be? Yay, he got it. You're never going to hear anything from God that you can't see as being reasonable based on your study of the Bible and what you know of his nature. And the Bible is what you want to hold everything up against. You can't hear from God that he wants you to leave your wife and marry this other girl so you can be happy. God will never say that. But I've heard a pastor actually tell me that. So be careful. Whoa, I guess I did hit a little close to home, but he was not the one. It is to me a scary thing to hear from God, but it's a scarier thing not to. And when we hear, we should only have one response. And I know, unless one of you happens to be fully Jesus now, and I'm not aware of it, that all of us have failed at times to be obedient.